Welcome to Pine Island United Methodist Church, where we exist to reach people with God's love, transform lives, and change the world. We're thrilled that you're joining us this morning for worship. Let's begin this morning with a word of prayer. Son of God, you walk on the waters of turmoil to meet us in the midst of your proposed journey for our lives. Help us to recognize your presence, remember your promise, and rely on your power and receive your peace through every storm. As we begin our worship service today, we remember our siblings in Maui who are going through their own storms. While they might not have a building to gather in, may they still experience you and know your presence today. Amen. Amen.
Will you please stand?
Yeah. my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah call. This is why it's to you I run. This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run. There's no space that his love can reach. There's no place where we can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on. I am.
Amen. Good morning. Please take this time to greet your neighbor and maybe find a new face to welcome today.
Well, I hate to interrupt all of you, but as you make your way back to your seats, I'll remind everyone to find the black book that's at the end of your pew. Go ahead and fill that in. Let us know that you're here today. Give us with your name and any information you want us to know, especially an email address. And with that, we'll get you signed up for our weekly newsletter that goes out every Wednesday with a mobile message and the calendar of events that are happening here. While I get started on announcements, will somebody remind Mo that she's up next? And then, just so she's ready and she's on deck, I just want to remind everyone that we will have membership Sunday, next Sunday, so we'll be taking in anyone who's interested in joining the church. And if that's you, if you've got some questions, if you've been curious, feel free to talk to me today after service or give me a call in the church office this week, and I'll try to answer any questions you have. We have a form. Marion Clark, our membership secretary, has a form for you to fill out, and then we'll take in a class of members next week. So let me know if you're interested in that. This month, the month of August, just another reminder that it is the month that for every $12.99 Bloomin' for Good bouquet that's purchased at Winn-Dixie, those are the bouquets with those red tags, Food for Kids program will receive a dollar back from that. So this is the month, buy the flowers, maybe buy a bouquet for a teacher who just started their school year and needs a little bit of sunshine in their life to remind them that what they're doing is good work. So, or buy a bouquet for a friend or a neighbor or just to brighten your own house. Today, after service, is our food and fellowship. So everyone, you are welcome to come. There will be light lunch provided, and then our team has made us homemade ice cream, and we just ask that everybody bring a favorite Sunday topping, but I am pretty sure if you didn't bring one, it's okay. There will be plenty for everyone. So even if you didn't bring something today, please plan to stay after and enjoy lunch with us over in Wesley Hall, which is over to my left, your right. And then following that, at 12:30, we will have our memorial service for Betsy Claflin back here in the sanctuary. So for anyone who's interested in coming to that. All right. So Mo, if we're ready for the kids and any kids that are in here and want to come up and join Mo, come on up. Melody, good morning. How are you today? So today we're learning about a story that you might have heard before, you might not have. And you want to go see your daddy? He's over here. You want to go see him? So we're learning about Jesus walking on water. It's something that he's known for, you know. But we're actually focusing more on before he walked on the water. And before he walked on the water, his disciples, his friends, were on the boat. And there was a big storm. And I don't know if you've ever been on a boat in the rain, but it's pretty scary. It was also nighttime when they were doing this, so it was dark, it was storming, there was thunder, there was rain, and there were really big waves. And they were really scared. And Jesus wasn't with them. At least, that's what they thought. But what they didn't know was that Jesus was on his way. He was coming to find them and to help them. So they were afraid, and they thought, Jesus isn't with us. What are we going to do? These waves are going to knock our boat over. But Jesus was already on the way. Jesus knew that they needed him, and he was coming. So even when we can't see Jesus, and we might think, oh, Jesus isn't with us right now, what are we going to do? He's already on his way. He's coming to help you, even if you can't see him. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for being there. We know that you're on the way, even if we can't see you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, everybody, let's go to our lesson now.
Well, as they make their way to kids' worship, and our ushers prepare to come and serve us today, I'll remind you that there are several ways that you can give, and those are listed for you on the screen. Lord of sea and storm, of sunshine and meadow, we present these offerings as tokens of our lives in grateful praise for your love for us. Use these gifts for the ministries of hope and justice in this, your broken world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Let us pray. God, you have given us senses to fully take in this life. Our faith is like the wind, invisible, but still present. So God, how do we know that they exist? Because we see the evidence of the wind by the sight and by the smell of smoke, by the sight and sounds of leaves rustling in the wind. Our faith has an outward signs that we experience in our worship service. The inspirational music presented by Carrie and Vince and Bob and Shelley and Mary. The special message that Mo brings to both big and little kids. The thought and soul-provoking messages that Pastor Kaylee brings us. The food and fellowship Larry, Jolene, and Luke bring us. God, there are signs of our faith all around us, and we thank you for the signs. In Jesus' name we pray. Now let's say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Give us this day trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. And all people said, Amen.
Good morning. Gail was slightly indisposed this morning, so she asked me if I would read the scripture. First, we'll be reading from Genesis. Jacob settled in the land where his father had lived as an alien, the land of Canaan. This is a story of the family of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was shepherding the flock with his brothers. He was a helper to the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives, and Joseph brought a bad report of them to their father. Now, Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his children because he was the son of his old age, and he had made him a long robe with sleeves. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not speak peaceably to him. Now his brothers went to pasture their father's flock near Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Are not your brothers pasturing the flock of Shechem? Come, I will send you to them." He answered, "Here I am." So he said to him, "Go now, see if it is well with your brothers and the flock, and bring word back to me." So he sent him from the valley of Hebron. He came to Shechem, and a man found him wandering in the fields. The man asked him, What are you seeking?" "I'm seeking my brothers," he said. "Tell me, please, where they are, where they're pasturing the flock." I heard him say, "They've gone away. Let us go to Dothan." So Joseph went after his brothers and found them at Dothan. They saw him from a distance, and before he came near to them, they conspired to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes this dreamer. Come now, let us kill him and throw him into one of the pits. Then we shall see a wild animal has devoured him. We shall see what will become of his dreams." But when Reuben heard it, he delivered him out of their hands, saying, "Let us not take his life." Reuben said to them, "Shed no blood. Throw him into this pit here in the wilderness, but lay no hand on him, that he might rescue him out of their land and restore him to his father." So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the long robe with sleeves that he wore, and they took him and threw him into the pit. The pit was empty. There was no water in it. Then they sat down to eat, and looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead, with their camels carrying gum, bald, and resin, on their way to carry it down to Egypt. Then Judah said to his brothers, "What profit is it if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him, for he is our brother, our own flesh." And his brothers agreed. When some Midianite traders passed by, they drew Joseph up, lifting him out of the pit, and sold him to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they took Joseph to Egypt. And now the reading from Matthew. Immediately the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, when he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, thank you, Shelley, for pinch hitting this morning and reading our scripture, and thank you, Richard, for that wonderful prayer this morning. Let's pray as I begin. God, open the eyes of our hearts. We want to see you. Jesus, open the ears of our hearts. We want to hear you. Holy Spirit, open our minds and our hearts today. We want to receive this message that you have for us. Amen. Well, the saga of the patriarchs continues. We last were with Jacob when he wrestled with a man the night before he was heading back to his homeland to meet up with his twin brother Esau. Well, the meeting took place, and believe it or not, Esau held no hard feelings. In fact, he ran to Jacob and met him with an embrace. He tried hard to get Jacob to come back with him, but Jacob, always the trickster, even after his name change, tells Esau that, well, he'll be along, but then actually changes course and goes a different direction. Now, many other things happen in Jacob's family between that meeting with Esau and our story today. And two of those things being that Rachel, Jacob's favored wife, died giving birth to her second son, Benjamin. And also Isaac, Jacob's father, died. He and Esau together buried him. And now Jacob has settled in Canaan, the land where Isaac lived. And quickly we see that Jacob is no longer going to be the focus of our story. We're now going to turn to Joseph, Jacob's 11th son, the firstborn of Jacob's favored wife, Rachel. And thus begins what is sometimes known as the Joseph novella, Genesis 37 through 50. Sadly, we are only going to spend 2 weeks on Joseph, but have no fear. Those 2 weeks will be filled with adventures. Now, many of us might be familiar with one version of the Joseph story, thanks to the Andrew Lloyd Webber musical, Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Now, while this musical is fun, I was actually in the older version of the show when I was in college, it doesn't give quite an accurate depiction of the story. I mean, first of all, I think that probably all of those involved with the story would agree that the real life version is nothing like a musical. I'm quite certain they didn't just sing everything. Also, Pharaoh, who we will meet next week, was not an Elvis Presley impersonator, as he is in the show. And Joseph, at least in his younger years, was probably not nearly as suave as Donny Osmond is, who plays Joseph in the show. So, in fact, young Joseph really was nothing short of a brat, plain and simple. As my grandma would have said, he was a little too big for his britches. Yeah? And not only is this boy the favorite, but he rubs it in the face of his brothers. You might think that Jacob would have learned something in his own growing up, perhaps that the harm that can happen when parents have favorite children, but obviously he learned nothing, because here he is doing exactly what his parents did. He has a favorite son, and he makes it known through the extravagant gift that he gives Joseph. Joseph is set against his brothers by their father. And now this gift. Friends, I need to tell you something. It wasn't really a Technicolor dream coat. We don't know a whole lot about it, but what we do know for sure is that it was extravagant. It extended all the way down to the wrists and all the way down to the ankles. Not very practical for a shepherd. The only other place that something like this is referred to is in 2 Samuel 13. Tamar, King David's daughter, is given this type of robe. It's a royal robe. A gift of a father to a child. The robe says something about the child's status. This son of Jacob's is special. He is Jacob's favorite son, and Jacob wants everyone to know it. And as you can imagine, whether you grew up with siblings or not, the other brothers, at least the 10 older ones, are not happy about this. They are, in fact, jealous, with a capital J. And Joseph is not innocent when it comes to this relationship with these brothers. He appears to take full advantage of his favored status by being a little tattletale. And no one likes a tattletale. I mean, if being the favorite wasn't enough, he had to go and give a bad report to their father. The brothers are fuming, so they wait for an opportunity. Now, what is left out of the reading for today, we skipped a few verses in the middle, is these dreams that Joseph also has. Not only does he have this fancy robe, not only has he tattled, but he also has these dreams, and he hasn't been shy about telling everyone about them. In the first dream, he and his brothers were gathering wheat into sheaves when suddenly his sheaf stood straight up and their sheaves bowed down to his. And then in his second dream, there was the sun, the moon, and 11 stars, and they were all bowing down to Joseph. And the sun and the moon in that dream are his mother and father. Now, Joseph seems to be fairly confident that these dreams are going to come to fruition someday. But the problem here is that Joseph's confidence crosses the line and enters into arrogance. Now, granted, he is young. We all do and say things when we are young that we regret later. But I'm wondering if anyone can relate to Joseph. I know I can. Those of us who are confident, we have to be careful that it doesn't come across as arrogance. Being confident we are right about something is one thing, but to take on an air of superiority is quite another. We must be careful not to get too big for our britches. And then it happens. The opportunity these brothers have been waiting for. Jacob sends Joseph out to see how things are going with the brothers. Now, right off, one might ask, what was Jacob thinking? Why would he do this? Doesn't he know the tension between these brothers? Well, perhaps he hoped that amends could be made, much like amends were made between he and Esau. But enough time has not passed for that to happen yet. These brothers are still having a hard time processing these dreams that Joseph had. And how is it for us when we hear the dreams of others? How do we hear and listen to them? Where is it that we might be prone to squash them? I mean, our human condition is to respond in fear and jealousy to dreams that are out of reach, that are unbelievable, that are threatening to us, that don't include us. What is the fear that won't allow you to let that dream come to fruition? Whether it's your own dream or someone else's. I think for these brothers, they were afraid that they weren't going to get what they felt they deserved, like the family inheritance. Perhaps they were afraid they wouldn't receive any recognition. I mean, they already played second fiddle with their own father compared to Joseph. They've been marginalized. And now they want Joseph to feel that too. Stories like this are confronting. We want to dislike the brothers. But how many times have we been like these brothers, or at least felt like them? From our bird's eye view, we can see the conflicts that are causing the problems in this story. Remember, last week we talked about wrestling and holding on. Well, this story is living that lesson out for us. In order to survive this story, we are going to have to hang on and fight for the presence of God within the tension and the harm done within this family of promise. It's not pretty, but it is very real. We are going to have to hang on and fight because God seems strangely absent from this story. The name of God is never spoken or mentioned here, which might cause us to ask, where is God? I might guess many of us have asked that question in the midst of very difficult situations. Perhaps here Joseph even asked it. Upon being thrown into that pit by his brothers. Maybe he asked it again as he was being taken out of the pit and sold off into slavery in Egypt. We don't know, but what we do know is this. God is very present with Joseph and even with the brothers, whether they see it or recognize it or know it. God is not making these awful things happen to Joseph. That is not what I'm saying. But God is present. We will know this in a clear way in part two of Joseph's story, but I don't want to spoil it. So I'm not going to tell you any more than this. Joseph thinks that his dreams are all about him, when in fact his dreams are God's vision for a community, a nation. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, writing in war-torn Germany in Christmas 1942, while he was in prison, wrote the following: I believe that God can and will let good come out of everything, even the greatest evil. I believe that even our mistakes and shortcomings are not in vain, and that it is no more difficult for God to deal with them than with our supposedly good deeds. Joseph made mistakes. The brothers made mistakes. Jacob made mistakes. We make mistakes. And yet, God is present and working. Joseph didn't know how his story would end that day when he was sold into slavery and taken to Egypt. We don't know how our stories are going to end either. But what we do know is this: God is present. Now, the disciples, they weren't too sure of this in the early morning hours when they saw what they thought was a ghost walking on the water. Right after they'd cleaned up all of those baskets of leftovers of the loaves and fishes, Jesus sent the disciples out in a boat to cross the Sea of Galilee. And he stayed behind and he dismissed the crowds. And then he went up the mountain and he got his much needed alone time, finally. Now, the perplexing question here for me is, how did Jesus plan to catch up with the disciples later? I mean, trains didn't run that late. The airport was probably closed due to weather. So what exactly was his plan? Well, alas, whatever it was, here he is walking on the sea toward the disciples who are in the boat that is battered by waves and wind. It says nothing about them being frightened until they see a figure out on the sea. And notice that Matthew does tell us that Jesus is walking on the sea. Later, Peter will walk on water, but Jesus walks on the sea. The difference is important because the sea represented all that opposed God. In the ancient world, the sea was the source of death and pain. When sailors set out on deep sea work, families would often perform rituals that were essentially funerals because they didn't expect to see them ever again. And if and when they did return, the reception was as though they had returned from the dead. The sea was the absence of God. That was the popular belief. But the biblical witness is that God is the God of the sea. Jesus, he walked on the sea. There is nowhere that God is not present, even the sea. And for Matthew, that boat is symbolically the church, adrift on the sea, and the storms are rising. That sea is a sea of confusion, of apathy, antagonism, and the people in it are wondering, can we make it to the other side on our own? And then Jesus shows up. But the disciples don't recognize him. I wonder what keeps us from recognizing Jesus. Could it be the same kinds of things? Anxiety, confusion, failure to anticipate miracles. Our expectations. I mean, we expect to meet God at church or even at the food pantry when we're serving, but do we imagine God's presence could meet us at the restaurant or at the grocery store? Could God reach out and surprise us even on an airplane? Our fears and our superstitions blind us to the arrival of the Holy. But ours is a God who comes at unexpected hours in unusual ways. I've heard Beth Moore say several times, God is never late, but seldom is God early. And so here Jesus is. He shows up, but at an unexpected place and time. And the disciples are scared. They're on edge, I imagine, and they are not expecting Jesus to show up in the middle of the sea. But here he is. And he says to these frightened disciples, "Don't be afraid. It's me." Or perhaps more properly, "It is I." Ego eimi in Greek. I am, as in the great I am of the burning bush fame. He's letting them know, I am here. Trust me. I am with you, even when you don't think so. I am. Oh, but Peter, bold, audacious Peter, he just can't sit there and wait for Jesus to come to the boat. He has to do something. So he asks Jesus to call him out on the water, and Jesus does, and just for a moment, Peter's faith is stronger than his doubt. But then he notices that wind and the fear comes back, and Peter begins to sink, not just sink, but drown, be overwhelmed. "Lord, save me," he cries, and Jesus does. He reaches out. He pulls Peter up, and as he does, he says to Peter, "You have little faith. Why did you doubt?" Now, often when we hear or read this story, we imagine that Jesus' question points to that moment when Peter was walking on the water and he took his eyes off Jesus. What if that isn't the moment of doubt that Jesus is referring to? What if, when Jesus says this to Peter, it isn't because Peter couldn't walk on the water? What if it's because Peter got out of the boat? Remember, back when Peter was in that boat and he called out to Jesus, "Lord, if it's really you, command me to come to you." Peter was doubting then. In the boat. What if that is the moment Jesus is referring to? What if his question is, "Peter, why did you doubt that it was me out here on the water? I told you it was me." But Peter didn't recognize Jesus in that moment. The greatest work of faith that Jesus asks of all of us is to trust in his presence, even when, or perhaps especially when, we can't feel it. When there is no external reason to believe that Christ is with us, that's when we need all the faith within us to get in, or perhaps to just stay in the boat and sail. Jesus was there. He was present. Just because Peter and the others didn't recognize him or feel his presence with them didn't mean that Jesus wasn't there. Just because God's name doesn't show up in Joseph's story, part one, does not mean that God is not present in the story and in the lives of Joseph's family. Jesus said to Peter, "You of little faith." Sometimes Little faith is all we can muster. And that is enough. Remember, small things like mustard seeds and yeast make big impacts. Hold on to your little faith and don't doubt that God is present even in the hard and difficult times in life. As our founder, John Wesley, said on his deathbed, actually, the best of it all is God is with us. Indeed, God is with us. We can hold on to that truth. Even when we don't see it or feel it, God is with us. Will you pray with me? Ever-present God, we are so thankful that you are with us. Even in the storms, even in the fires, in the hard places, you are there. Even when we don't see you or feel you, when we don't recognize you, you are still there. Give us the strength today to hold on to that promise, to hold on to our faith, even if it is small, knowing that small doesn't mean insignificant. Give us the strength to hold on to this when we start to doubt and to remember that you are there. Amen.
Will you please stand?
You know that the next words are, even when you can't see it, he's working. Even when you can't feel it, he's working. And that is the truth. Our God is present with us. John Wesley was right. The best thing of it all is that God is with us. Amen. Amen.
God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. Don't forget food and fellowship over in Wesley Hall. I hope to see all of you there.